For years, millions of people have trusted All Things Secure to provide them with timely on-
Psst, hey, did you know that you can make boatloads of money in this new crypto scheme that everyone's talking-
Whoa, wait a second, hold up. I don't endorse that at all.
You've won, congratulations. In order to claim your prize, you're gonna need to send us all kinds of information, including your name, your home address, your bank account number, your social security.
Stop it, please don't send all that info to anybody.
This email is to inform you that All Things Secured has charged your credit card $256. If you think this charge was made in error, please click this button to contact us and let us know.
No. Don't click that button. What's interesting about being a creator, or any small business for that matter, is that many times our greatest threat is not somebody stealing our money or our data, but rather somebody stealing the trust that we've built with our customers and with you, my audience. That's what happened to my friend Justin Moore from Creator Wizard.
I started getting a bunch of replies to my email calling me a scammer. Like, hey, stop scamming me, like, screw you, this type of thing.
The crazy thing is that Justin had not been hacked. But even if he had, what's interesting is that the attacker wasn't looking to harm Justin. The same can be said for Linus, whose massive YouTube channel was hacked in early 2023.
The fireworks started a little after 3 in the morning when the Linus Tech Tips account was renamed to Tesla and started streaming a podcast-style recording of self-proclaimed techno king Elon Musk discussing cryptocurrency.
Poor Linus, right? No. Linus may have lost out on a small bit of ad revenue, but the real victims were likely the hundreds or maybe even thousands of people in his audience who clicked on a crypto scam that they thought was legit. Linus probably has insurance to cover his naked behind, but those people in his audience? Not so much. The attacker was stealing and exploiting the trust that Linus had built with his audience. If we look again at my friend Justin, you can see how this can easily unfold.
And there was like this, oh, you have a shipping notification, like click here to update your address or whatever, like obviously a scam. And I had never sent out an email like that.
Now let's stop there for a moment. Do you realize how easy it is for somebody to impersonate you and to send emails from your domain? One of the first things that I tell people about avoiding scam email is to look at that from address. Is the address legit or is it misspelled in any way? But without the proper authentication, it is scary easy for somebody to simply send an email that gives every indication that it comes from your trusted domain. I even had that happen to me last year where I had some Russian IP address sending emails from the allthingssecure.com domain. I don't know who received those emails, but hopefully they weren't duped into believing some scam just because they entrusted that All Things Secure domain. And while the important thing to consider is how this impacts customers and followers, having tons of people start marking your email as spam doesn't help you either.
My biggest fear, if I did not figure this out, was that my reputation score with all the email service providers would tank.
Justin, like me and maybe even you, has invested a lot into building an email contact list to communicate directly with his audience. And if email service providers like Gmail, Yahoo, Outlook, and others start to think that your domain isn't trustworthy, they're gonna start putting all the emails you send into the spam folder. Thankfully, when it comes to email, the solution is pretty simple. And I'm gonna see if I can explain this in a way that pretty much anybody can understand. And then once I'm done, I'll share 3 important pieces of advice that I wish somebody had told me when I was doing this. Okay, imagine with me for a moment that I'm sending an email to my friend Joe, and this message arrives at the door of his hypothetical inbox. Now, every inbox has a bouncer that decides what to do with all of this incoming mail. Does it go straight to spam? Does it go to your promotions folder? Does it go into your primary inbox? And part of how that bouncer does his job is by authenticating the messages and who is sending them. So first things first, I want to make sure that I'm on the trusted guest list. This is the SPF, or Sender Policy Framework. When an email is received, the SPF tells the email service, like Gmail, whether or not the sender of that email is authorized to use that particular domain. So I can't send an email and pretend to be Amazon.com or Netflix.com because the SPF record would indicate that I'm not authorized to use that domain. Next, the bouncer checks the message itself. The message I sent is sealed with the signature that allows the bouncer to verify that the message wasn't altered in any way during delivery and that it did in fact come from the claimed sender. This is DKIM, which stands for Domain Keys Identified Mail, which digitally signs every email message with my private key. Finally, we have instructions for the bouncer. Let's say that somebody tries to get into this email party but uses a fake ID or presents a seal that's been tampered with. The bouncer is given a set of rules that tells him what to do with that cheater. This is DMARC, which stands for Domain-Based Message Authentication Reporting and Conformance. This set of rules for your specific domain, or your DMARC policy, informs the bouncer that whenever a message from this URL is identified as fake, whether he should do nothing, whether he should allow these emails in but move them to spam, or whether he should block them from getting in altogether. Now, even if this analogy doesn't make complete sense to you, there's one important thing I want you to take away. Not giving instructions to this bouncer, some kind of authentication process for your email domain, it isn't just an oversight, it is simply foolish. The main reason that a lot of creators and small business owners don't set up this important authentication is often the same reason that I didn't do it for the longest time and why my friend Justin was hesitant.
When I started like just going down the Google and YouTube rabbit hole of the various things that I needed to do to update those records, it seemed as though everyone was like saying, be really, really careful when you start messing with these records because it could mean that no one gets your emails.
I've already done a video tutorial showing how you can set up these DMARC records on your own. But the more that I talk with people, the more I realize that if you have your own email domain, using a DMARC service isn't just recommended, it's really almost necessary at this point. I don't know anybody who has the time to analyze the flood of reports that come in an XML format to understand what's going on with your email authentication. I want to offer you three pieces of advice, but before I do, I want to try to make Justin proud by sharing with you the DMARC service that I recommend and who have graciously sponsored this video. After setting up my all things secure domain through EasyDMARC, I now have complete confidence and peace of mind that my messages are being authenticated properly and that nobody else can use my domain to steal the trust I've built with those who receive my emails. The authentication boosts my authority with the email bouncers, which means my emails are more likely to be delivered to your primary inbox, and it's super easy for me to monitor the entire authentication and delivery process. I can forget all of those confusing acronyms and just focus on what matters. I trust EasyDMARC with my email domain, and it's surprisingly fast to get everything set up. You can sign up for free at EasyDMARC.com and get 10% off using the promo code ATSPROMO at checkout. Now that you're ready to start protecting the trust that your email domain represents, let me give you three pieces of advice. First, when you're doing this, you want to start with SPF and DKIM. These are the two that require input from any place where you send emails. That could be Google Workspace, MailChimp, ConvertKit, basically any service that sends emails using your domain. They will provide you with all the stuff that you need to set up these records in your DNS. Sometimes you don't even realize which services do that, by the way. It wasn't until I started monitoring my EasyDMARC reports that I realized that my website hosting service also sends emails via that contact form that I have. And if I wanted to receive those messages, I need to make sure that I include my website host in an SPF and a DKIM record. All of this information has to come from the service itself, so doing a simple Google search for, let's say, MailChimp SPF or your website host SPF should give you what you need. My second piece of advice is to give you permission to ease your way into this. As you get started, you might feel a little bit like Justin did.
So I was just like super confused. I didn't know what to do. I don't have a ton of experience with this. Well, so it was just, oh my God, it was so stressful.
I get it. I was too. I mean, if you're worried you're gonna screw something up, simply start with a DMARC policy of none, which means that no actions are taken, even if you set up all of these SPF and DKIM records incorrectly. You can monitor your reports through a service like EasyDMARC to see if everything passes correctly, and then upgrade your security from there. For example, I felt pretty confident that I had set up all my records correctly, but I didn't want to take any chances, so I started with a DMARC policy of quarantine. I monitored my DMARC reports every day just to see if any of the emails I was sending were getting quarantined or weren't getting delivered, but everything was fine. It was working as it should. So after a couple of weeks of testing it out, I moved to a DMARC policy of reject. And in the end, this is what you want to get to. To fully secure your email against bad actors, you need to move to a DMARC reject policy. Keeping a none or a quarantine is about as useful as keeping an iron safe in your home, but never closing and locking it. Finally, my last piece of advice is to put a reminder on your calendar, or maybe even somebody on your team, to monitor your reports no less than once a month. I mean, if you send out a lot of emails, you might want to keep an eye once a week. The point here is that you want to know what's happening with your email. One of the things that I like about using EasyDMARC is that they send me a message anytime an email fails the DMARC check so that I can find out what's happening exactly. Again, it's just that peace of mind knowing that I've done everything I can to protect my email and anybody who receives my messages. Make sense? Well, if not, leave a comment below or watch this video where I walk you through the process step by step. But honestly, the best thing you can do is go to easydmarc.com and create an account. It's free to start using, and it will help you check if you've set up all of these DMARC records correctly.